Simon & Schuster Audio presents We're Right, They're Wrong, a handbook for spirited progressives, written and read by James Carville.
The first person to ever slap me on the ass was a federal employee, and I didn't even sue him. He was the Army doctor at Fort Benning, Georgia, who brought me into this world. My daddy was serving at Fort Benning as an infantry officer, so he and my mama were able to start me off with some fine federal health care. You'd have to say the federal government made a big impression on me early in life. I grew up in a town in southern Louisiana by the name of Carville, and that's no coincidence. The town got that name because my family provided the town with its most indispensable federal employee, its postmaster. Three generations of Carville served as postmaster, starting with my great-grandmother, Octavia Duhon, who was more properly referred to back then as a postmistress. Believe it or not, working for the federal government was a source of family pride. You see, the federal government was not considered a bad thing when I was growing up. First of all, it kept my feet dry. Before I was born, the Mississippi River used to overflow its banks every spring and flood the whole town of Carville and many other towns like it. It was a Washington bureaucrat who got the idea we could build a levee system to stop the flooding, and the federal taxpayers helped us do it. It was the heavy hand of government at work. Washington bureaucrats also came up with the idea that black children should be able to go to school with white children. Integration was the searing issue when I was a kid. After the Brown versus Board of Education decision in 1954, people in Carville, which was 85% black, stopped talking about football and the weather. All they wanted to do was scream about race. Like most whites, I took segregation for granted and wished the blacks just didn't push so damn hard to change it. But when I was 16 years old, I read To Kill a Mockingbird, and that novel changed everything. I got it from the lady who drove around in the overheated old bookmobile in my parish, another government program, I might add. I couldn't put it down. I stuck it inside another book and read it under my desk during school. When I got to the last page of that book, I closed it and said, "They're right and we're wrong." The issue was literally black and white, and we were absolutely, positively on the wrong side. I've never forgotten which side the federal government was on. Federal and state governments helped me get an education and a start in life. They offered me all kinds of loans and a GI Bill so I could earn myself undergraduate and law degrees at Louisiana State University. They picked up my salary when I served as a corporal in the United States Marine Corps, and again when I taught 8th grade science at a tiny little public school for boys in South Vashon, Louisiana. Government did right by me. I'm the first one to admit that fact. No, let's back up for a minute. I don't just admit that fact, I savor it. I hold it up as an example of what government should be in the business of doing, providing opportunity. You will never catch me saying I'm a self-made man. I am not. My parents gave me their love, their example, and the benefit of their hard work, and the government gave me a big hand. Unfortunately, for a lot of politicians, it isn't convenient to give the government any credit for the things it does right. Here's one of my favorite examples. Ronald Reagan used to love to talk about a guy named Joseph Giordano. He was the surgeon who saved Reagan's life in 1981 after the president was shot in front of the Washington Hilton. Dr. Giordano was Reagan's perfect human interest story. He was the son of a milkman and the grandson of poor immigrants from Italy. Thanks to his own hard work and that of his parents, Giordano got himself through college and medical school and went on to become a prominent surgeon at a great hospital and then to save a president's life. The American dream in spades. But you see, Dr. Giordano wasn't too enamored of the way Reagan was telling his life story. He thought the president had left a few details out of the picture, like school loans and federal funding for his medical research. Here's a bit of what Dr. Giordano said about the matter in the Los Angeles Times under the headline, "Facts for the President's Fable." In contrast to the president, who feels that government programs make people so dependent that they lose initiative, I feel that these programs have enabled people with little resources to reach their full potential. The doc said it all. The purpose of this program is to say that we were right when we made investments in people, and that it's wrong to let the Republicans snatch these investments away to pay for tax cuts for those who don't need our help. It's all about priorities. I know that dollars are tight and the country just isn't growing like it was when I was a kid. But that should be all the more reason to invest wisely. To my way of thinking, there's no wiser investment than opportunity, no better way to hold this country together than to make sure everybody has at least a chance to get ahead. A few years ago, one of my nephews was trying futilely to break his Uncle James's record for utter academic failure by busting out of college without a job. My mama, who is known to most of Louisiana as Miss Nippy, informed my nephew that there were only two acceptable activities for a human being between the ages of 5 and 65, being in training for a job or having a job. My nephew was doing neither, and that was unacceptable. What Miss Nippy's 5 to 65 philosophy says to me is this: work and training for work are core values. They are values that built this country. On this program, you're going to hear me talking a lot about what we need to do to promote work and training for work. And I'm going to start by calling myself a 5 to 65 Democrat, and I'll be happy to share the term with any of you. As I see it, the great divide in this world is between people who believe that education, training, work, and opportunity are the essential ingredients to building a strong and more prosperous nation, 5 to 65 Democrats, and people who don't. You know who I'm talking about. It's the people who want to cut school loans and grants so they can cut capital gains taxes for the rich. People who want to throw people off of welfare without helping them get the tools they need to go to work. People who want to slash the Earned Income Tax Credit and other programs that reward people for lifting themselves up through work. People have sucked from the government's sugar tit all of their lives and now want to make sure it runs dry for everyone else. It's them versus us. Ours is the morally superior position. We're right, they're wrong. Last night, I had a dream. One of my wife's friends was going to have a huge barbecue for the 4th of July. Sure, it was going to be a chest-thumping, live-free-or-die kind of Republican affair, but I have to admit it, it sounded great. This friend had a big farmhouse set in the most beautiful part of Virginia, with acres of fields for our dogs to run around and lots of cows for them to bark at. And based on prior experience, I knew the food was going to be first rate. I will admit it, Republican gatherings always have better food than Democratic ones. The only good thing about a Republican Party is the food. But about this dream, wouldn't you know it, at the last minute Mary couldn't go, she had to run off and give a speech at a convention of truck stop hairdressers or some such thing, and I was on my own. I was pissed. Without Mary to run interference from time to time, an all-Republican affair can be brutal. I'd made plans to ditch the barbecue and watch the Marine Corps band play, but when Mary heard I wasn't going, she threatened to start calling me Serpent Head on a TV show every night. I caved. When I got to the farmhouse, the gravel road out front was jam-packed with cars. All of them nice, most of them foreign. Some of the bumper stickers I saw were truly frightening. Guns don't kill people. Kids on welfare do. Screw the geezers. They don't vote for us anyway. Get government out of Medicare and back in the bedroom where it belongs. Man, it was going to be a rough crowd. I took my two dogs out of my truck, put them on leashes, and walked around the back of the house where all the music and good smells were coming from. I was right about the chow. The first thing I saw was a big wooden bowl full of that real good potato salad, the kind with homemade mayonnaise and fresh dill. And sure enough, there were steaming hot ears of silver queen corn. Then I got myself some tasty-looking beef brisket. You know, like three or four slices with some real good Vidalia onions and a sweet Texas-style barbecue sauce, and for good measure, an overstuffed pulled pork sandwich with spicy slaw. Then I went over to the keg and pulled some ice-cold beer into a frosted glass. I couldn't wait to dig in. I was about halfway through my corn when things started to get nasty. The country tunes that had been playing suddenly turned into the theme music from Jaws. I saw a horde of Republicans making their way over to my table, moving in for the kill. These were no ordinary Republicans. Leading the way was the one and only Newt Gingrich, his plate barely able to contain...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.